tonight, Nehemiah 8, 2 Timothy 3 is your single cross-reference. You know that on Wednesday nights, we are going verse by verse, chapter by chapter, book by book, through the Old Testament. And we've come to Nehemiah 8 tonight, which, if you know Nehemiah, you know this is a key chapter in the entire Bible. This isn't just a key chapter in the book of Nehemiah or in the story of those who returned during the post-exilic period. This is a key chapter in the entire Bible. It gives us so much direction. It's just an amazing, amazing chapter. So what I'd like to do tonight is I'd like to begin by reading to you the first 12 verses of the chapter. We will spend, we'll study the whole chapter tonight, but we're just going to lay a foundation by reading the first 12 verses of Nehemiah 8. And then what we'll do is we'll explain what the verses mean. And then afterwards, we'll talk about how they apply to our lives. So reading with me, please. Actually, I'll start at 773. Chapter 7, verse 73. So the priests, the Levites, the gatekeepers, the singers, some of the people, the Nethinim, and all Israel dwelt in their cities. When the seventh month came, the children of Israel were in their cities. Now all the people gathered together as one man in the open square that was in front of the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. So Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of men and women and all who could hear with understanding on the first day of the seventh month. Then he read from it in the open square that was in front of the water gate from morning until midday before the men and women, and those who could understand. And the ears of the people were attentive to the book of the law. So Ezra the scribe stood on a platform of wood which they had made for the purpose, and beside him at his right hand stood Mattathiah, Shema, Ananiah, Urijah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. And at his left hand, Padiah, Mishael, Malchijah, Hashem, Hashbadana, Zechariah, and Meshulam. Verse 5, and Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. Then all the people answered, Amen, Amen, while lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads, and they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Also, Yeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shabbatai, Hodiah, Maaseiah, Kelita, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, Peliah, and the Levites helped the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So they read distinctly from the book in the law of God, and they gave the sense, and they helped them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn nor weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So the Levites quieted all the people, saying, Be still, for the day is holy, do not be grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and drink, to send portions and rejoice greatly, because they understood the words that were declared to them. One of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible, and I'm so excited to teach it tonight. Now, as we go through the next three or so weeks, we'll cover chapters 8, 9, and 10. And during these chapters, what we're going to see is a genuine revival breaking out among the people of God. Now, the reason I keep using the word genuine and real as I'm talking about revival is that oftentimes people, groups of churches or something will speak about a revival, but it won't match the biblical picture of a revival. So what we're seeing in the text tonight is that a revival has a specific look to it. Starting here in chapter 8, what we're going to see is that the people will return to the simple but very thorough teaching of the Word of God, accompanied by worship that takes place in spirit and in truth, according to what Jesus said in the Gospel of John. And then next week in chapter 9, what we'll see is that God's Word from chapter 8 is going to bring conviction from the Holy Spirit, fruitful confession of sin, and real repentance in chapter 9. And then in chapter 10, the people that heard the Word of God and then recommitted themselves to God are going to now recommit themselves to full obedience to the Word of God. And so we've got kind of this overarching picture of what a real revival looks like. But what we have in chapter 8 is five principles that Nehemiah records, the Holy Spirit records through the pen of Nehemiah, of what a genuine, real revival looks like. These are five essential elements of a genuine revival among God's people. Now, the first, if you look down at chapter 7, verse 73, through chapter 8, verse 1, the first that we're going to see here is that God's people chose to forsake what was good in order to focus on what was best. And I want to say that again. It's up on the screen. The first essential element in a real revival is that God's people choose to forsake what is good in order to focus on what is best. Beginning in 773 through the first line of chapter 8, verse 1, so the priests, the Levites, the gatekeepers, the singers, some of the people, the Nethinim, and all Israel dwelt in their cities. And then when the seventh month came, the children of Israel were in their cities. Now, this is very important because once the wall was finished, a couple of chapters back, the wall was completely finished. Nehemiah had to send the people of Judah back to their cities and back to their villages so that they could get back to their personal responsibilities. Now, what we see here is that God gave all of these different men from these different towns and villages things that they had to care for. And I'll give you a list of some of the things that I think these men had to return to. First of all, would have been families. Pretty important for a man to care for his family, wouldn't you say? And then what about his business or his job? That's pretty important, right? It's not that the boss gave them time off to go build the wall. It's that the boss was there building the wall also. Everybody went to build the wall, so they go back and they return to care for their families and then to care for their lands that might need to be cultivated. And they're returning to their careers, and I'll bet that there were people in the land of Judah that had entrepreneurial endeavors that they were working on. They're saying, man, look at all this opportunity before us. Let's do something new, you know? And then I hope that this doesn't blow anybody's mind, but as you look at Scripture, God is okay with you having a hobby. Going to the gym, exercising, riding your mountain bike, going out on your motorcycle on Sunday, these things are okay. All work and no play, you know, makes the Christian a very dull person. Look through Scripture. What did David do? David wrote songs. David wrote poetry. He had hobbies. These things are okay to have, but here's the thing is that these things have to be kept balanced because God also called each of these men who had been working on the wall and were now back in their own towns and villages, he called them to be active members of this growing community of faith called the city of Jerusalem. And so there were times where these men were supposed to be at their job, caring for their family, going for the entrepreneurial venture, riding their mountain bike, going to the gym, riding them, whatever they were doing, that was okay. There were times where it was good. They were supposed to be doing that. But as you look now, we get here, it is the seventh month, the first day of the seventh month, which is a key month in the Jewish calendar. It's the beginning of the fall festivals. In other words, this is the time that the people of Judah should have been turning their hearts away from my daily grind, my daily responsibilities, my trip to the gym, my trip to the mountains, my hiking, boating, swimming, diving, whatever it is. And they were supposed to be turning their attention back to the city of Jerusalem, where they would have been celebrating the fall festivals. Now, what's really cool here is that I believe that what God's doing here, closing chapter 7 and bringing us into chapter 8, is he's showing people of every generation from the time of Nehemiah right up to the time that you and I live, he's showing us something that is so, so, so important. And I talk about this as often as it comes up in the text because I think it's something that every person wrestles with. God's showing us that there's a time to be with our family, there's a time to be at our job, there's a time to pursue some new entrepreneurial venture, you know, time to go to the gym and ride your mountain bike and all these things. And when it's the time to do that, I tell you from the New Testament, do it as unto the Lord with all your heart. When you are with your wife, guys, give her your full undivided attention. When you're with your children and grandchildren and at work and whatever you're doing, you better do it 100% as unto the Lord, because that's how we're called to be as Christians. But it's interesting because there's also a time to focus on the things of God. There's a time where you've got to say, do I take the kids to the 27th soccer practice this week, or do we go to this special event that's going on at the church? Do we go to the 75th ballet thing this week, or do we go to church and do what God's calling us to do? And what we're seeing here is that the average person living in Judah at this time was so caught up in their day-to-day responsibilities, everything that they had to do, they had forgotten that it was day one of the seventh month. That's our middle of September going into October, if you want to look at our fall calendar. They had totally forgotten that they were supposed to stop what they were doing and go spend time with the people of God, worshiping God. So, notice the first sentence of verse 8. They're consumed with themselves. They're not consumed with serving the Lord. And so it says here in verse 1, how all the people gathered together as one man in the open square that was in front of the water gate. Wow. Something happened. All of a sudden, they realize, hey, we're not supposed to just be doing our thing at home and at work and at the gym and this. We're supposed to be with the people of God, doing something with God. And so they all kind of hightail it back to Jerusalem. This takes place at a very specific part of Jerusalem. It's the eastern side of Jerusalem where water flowed into the city, where water was brought in. It's called the Watergate, not Nixon's Watergate. This is the Watergate in the city of Jerusalem. And what's so cool is as you study scripture, the word of God is compared multiple times to water. And what we're going to see tonight is that the water of the word is going to flow into the city of Jerusalem, is going to flow into the people of Jerusalem, and is going to radically transform this group of people. So this is what happens. For some reason that we'll know in just a minute, everybody sets aside their personal pursuits and they gather together at the Watergate. And I want you to pay special attention to a phrase that the Holy Spirit included as he describes the manner in which they gathered. Notice that they gathered, verse 1, as one man. Do you see that there? I'm so frustrated right now with that phrase, as one man. You want to know why? Because my method of studying is I study and I study and I study and I make sure that I've learned what the scriptures are teaching. I make sure that I'm listening to what the Lord wants me to say to you. And then I go look at the commentators. And you know that nobody in any of the commentaries that I was looking at today even covered this? Nobody talked about the fact that they gathered as one man. And I mean, that just blows me away because that's the one phrase that just sticks out at me. There's a couple of things here. You know, they gathered in unity. And you know what the cool thing about unity is? It requires diversity. So this is what I think was happening. At the Watergate, you had the guys in the three-piece suits and the ties. And then you had the guys who showed up in flip-flops, shorts, and a t-shirt, right? And then you had guys who showed up with long hair and no beard, and a bunch of guys who showed up with beards and short hair. Isn't that a thing now? Almost a shaved head and this great big beard. I think it's a cool look. I can't grow a beard. It's just, this is about the best I get right here. But they came as one man. Unity requires diversity. And I really love the fact that it doesn't say here that this sect gathered on this side, and then this sect, they sat in the middle. The one sect, they all sat in the back so they could talk about the people in front of them who were different. There was unity. Different people, different backgrounds, different views on politics and all this stuff, but they gathered as one man. And this is kind of what's going on. They're all there. And how is it that God can gather a bunch of very, very different people and gather them in unity? Because something had just happened in the city of Jerusalem that changed their lives, that rocked their world. Back when Nehemiah arrived, what people saw was this high-ranking official from King Artaxerxes' court who comes with this entourage and enters into the city, and he's got money with him, and he's got resources with him, and he's got people with him, and he's got people that are going to become leaders and people that are going to become servants. And it's obvious that he's got a love for the Lord and a passion for God, and it's obvious that he's got leadership skills. And then what he does a midnight survey, and he comes and he gets all the people together, and he requires every single person in the city to be part of the building project. He tells everybody, you will hold a tool in your hand and you will use that tool. And then when the enemy comes on and threatened them, he called everybody back together and he says, you will keep a tool in one hand and you will keep a weapon in the other hand. You will build the city and you will defend the city. And at the end of 52 days, despite all sorts of incredible attack, even on his very life, this guy leads a bunch of misfit, feeble, Jewish, returned captives to do something that could not be done in the previous 120 some years. And everybody just says, you know what? I don't care how different we are. We can follow a man like that. And we want to be back where God is working. We want to be where God is doing something really exciting. And so when we heard that we were supposed to gather on the first day of the seventh month, we just abandoned everything we were doing. We locked the doors. We fed the animals. And here we are. And I wonder what God's going to do. You know what? I love it when we gather. Sometimes before church, someone will walk up to me and I'll just say, how's it going? How's things? And you know, then someone will go, I'm just so excited to be in church today. And I just can't leave it at that. Why are you excited? Because God's working here. And I think God's going to work again today. It excites me so much. I want you to look up at the screen. Leviticus 23:23. Then the Lord spoke to Moses. This is a long time ago, way before Nehemiah's time. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first day of the month, you shall have a Sabbath rest, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work on it. You shall offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. It goes on and on. The parallel passage in the book of Numbers goes on and on even further, telling them how to have this Feast of Trumpets and what to do and how to worship God and how to do all these other things. I want to share with you a personal opinion. And this is just a personal opinion. I don't know if this is actually right or not. And that's why I'm telling you, this is just my personal opinion. But as you read the text, you say, how in the world did these people end up in the city of Jerusalem on the first day of the seventh month, when we already see that at the first of the seventh month, they were all home doing their own thing. They were doing their own thing. Just a personal opinion. But I believe, based on what I saw when we studied the book of Ezra, something very similar, that just before Nehemiah told all these workers, okay, go home, get back to your normal lives, get back to everything, that Ezra stepped up and just kind of said, hey, folks, before you go. And I think he read to them from Leviticus 23:23, maybe the parallel passage from Numbers chapter 29. And he said to them, please pull out your smartphones, turn your ringers back on, and set an appointment for the first day of the seventh month, because we're going to gather back here again for the next event on God's calendar, because we're his people. And our lives revolve around worshiping him. And the next event where we're called to gather was told to us in Leviticus 23:23, the first day of the seventh month. You need to be here. And I think they all woke up and their smartphones went beep, 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 beep. Jerusalem, first day of the seventh. Oh my, and everybody's freaking out. Ah! You know, it's just mass exodus into the city. Is that an exodus? A mass influx to the city of Jerusalem to have this worship service. And I bet Ezra in the morning, kind of like me sometimes Sundays at 10 o'clock, when I look around, I'm like, nobody's coming today. Ezra probably woke up first day of the seventh month and he's looking at the city going, bummer. I said, 1, 2, 3. Oh, those are my kids, you know, my wife and kids. And then by the time the day goes on a little bit further, Jerusalem's packed with worshipers. Everybody's there, everybody's ready. Now, this leads us to the second half of verse 1, where we're going to see the second essential element for a real revival. Remember, the first one was that God's people forsook what was good in order to focus on what was best. They got rid of just, hey, going through daily life. They said, we're going to Jerusalem to worship. Second thing that we see about a real revival is that the people now were hungry for the word of God. You can't have a real revival if people aren't hungry for the word of God. Look at the wording, second half of verse 1. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. He told them, come to Jerusalem the first day of the seventh month. They arrived and they're telling Ezra, Ezra, did you bring your Bible? Ezra, do you have your Bible? Ezra, open your Bible. Ezra, teach us from the Bible. They told Ezra to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. I love it when I arrive and people go, hey, what are we studying today? What are we going to look at, man? What's God's word going to say? I love it. I want to tell you what they didn't do. And this is just cultural, but the people of Jerusalem didn't come and say, hey, are we going to do that new program? I got an email about church growth, and if you do this program, your church will explode. Are we going to do that? They didn't do that. They came and they said, will you please teach us the Bible? I want you to notice what else they didn't do. They didn't come and say, hey, Ezra, I've been like surfing websites, and all the big popular churches, they're all doing this sermon series on this hot topic. Are we going to do that sermon series on that hot topic? They said, Ezra, come teach us the Bible. Read to us from God's word. Now, why did they do this? How come they didn't go to somebody else? I want you to just think real clearly. Go all the way back to the first 6 chapters of the book of Ezra. This guy named Zerubbabel is charged with leading the people of God back to Jerusalem during the first wave of returning exiles. His name was Zerubbabel. He was commissioned to rebuild the temple. Jump ahead to the first 6 chapters of the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah commissioned to go back to the city of Jerusalem and build a wall. But when you look at the 7th chapter of the book of Ezra, the Holy Spirit clearly tells us Ezra was a scribe. He was an expert in the word of God. And he was sent to rebuild not the city, not the temple, not the wall. He was called to rebuild the people of God by teaching them, say it with me, the word of God. Ezra came to rebuild the people of God by teaching them the word of God. And so the people knew this. They knew when he arrived 14 years before this, that the first thing he did is gather the people and start teaching them the word. And the first wave of revival started, but the people got lethargic. The people fell away from the Lord. And so they realized God has done this amazing thing among us. He's allowed us to rebuild the wall in the presence of our enemies. We're not going to make the same mistake again. So as they come back to Jerusalem, they call Ezra and they basically say, Ezra, teach us. Now, I want to remind you of something. King Artaxerxes doesn't even really believe in God, as far as we can tell from studying his life and from studying history and stuff. But Artaxerxes looks at Ezra and he says, this is what you do. When you go back, you teach the people of God the word of God, and then you hold them accountable to what it says. If they break the standards of the word of God, you judge them and punish them according to that. So Ezra was probably known as more of a fierce Bible teacher. Probably wasn't like a Calvary Chapel guy where he focused a lot on the grace of God. We love the grace of God, don't we? Ezra had a little bit different ministry under the old covenant. Ezra was probably a hellfire and brimstone preacher. And I don't think he said a lot of times, you're going to go to hell, brother, something like that. I don't think that was how he was. But I think what he did is he read the word of God and he said, and look at the blessing that comes from obeying the word of God. And all the people would go, hallelujah, amen. And Ezra would go, but as we continue reading, we see the fierce wrath of God that comes upon those who disobey. And probably people were like, slipping down in their chairs, you know. Ezra was a very knowledgeable but fierce teacher of the word because he had a very different ministry than we have under the new covenant. He had to tell people much more than we do about the consequences of disobeying the Lord. Do you realize how amazing the new covenant is? That Jesus took the consequence for all of our sin? What an amazing blessing. Now, that is not a cheap grace message. That is not. If you've been here the last two Sundays, you know that we have clearly covered from 2 Peter chapter 2, there is no such thing as the biblical teaching of Jesus saved you so you can do anything you want. That is pure heresy. Jesus saved us, and he set us free from the power of sin, so why would we ever want to continue in it, right? Amen? That was quite a tangent. That's not anywhere even near my notes. But I want you to see the people were hungry for the word of God. And the third thing I want you to see, this third essential element for real revival, and this is verses 2-8, is that the word of God and the worship of God became the main focus in Jerusalem during the feast time. This is so cool here. So Ezra, verse 2, we've gotten through a whole verse. Ladies and gentlemen, that is amazing. So Ezra the priest, he brought the law before the assembly of men and women and all who could hear with understanding on the first day of the seventh month. Then he read from it in the open square that was in front of the water gate from morning until midday before the men and women and those who could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. I want to look at a couple of words and phrases that I think are extremely important right here. They've given me some really strong direction for my ministry over the years. Verse 2, I want you to notice this, that the law, in other words, this would have been the scroll containing the Pentateuch, Genesis through Deuteronomy, okay? The law was brought before all who could hear with understanding. Then I want you to notice verse 3. Ezra talks about those who could understand. And then verse 3. The ears of the people were attentive to God's word. The end goal of any Bible teaching is that the people listening can learn, be attentive, and grow because of what they've learned. Now, I want you to see something. As you read verses 2 and 3, like we just did, we see that Ezra had a goal, and his goal is my goal. I learned this from Ezra, but it's been the focus of my ministry as long as I've been teaching the Bible. My goal in my ministry, like Ezra, is to teach the word of God to the people of God in a manner that helps them both understand and know the Bible, understand and know God because of the Bible, and understand and know how to personally apply what we've just learned. If we talk tonight and you go out of here and you don't know the Word of God better, you don't know the God of the Word better, and you don't know how to apply what we've taught, I have wasted an hour of your time. And if I'm doing that multiple times a week, you need to find a new church and let me know on the way out what I'm doing wrong, gently, But I can tell you this, the way that we've built our leadership structure here, I have an enormous amount of time to devote to studying. And I come to this pulpit with a clear conscience every time, because I know that the word is taught, and you can learn, you can apply if you choose to. If you don't, you can't be one of those people who leaves our church and says, well, I'm just not being fed here. You're a liar if you say that. Everybody who teaches in this church teaches. And so you can't come to our church and say, I'm not being fed. What you can say is, I'm not learning. And we'll talk about reasons for that in a couple of minutes. But I want you to notice a couple of things. Ezra had a plan for his ministry. And his plan is kind of laid out in this next section here. I want you to see the first thing about Ezra's teaching plan and his ministry plan. Please pay so close attention to this. It was age appropriate and it was orderly. Just really hear that. It was age appropriate and it was orderly. In verses 2 and 3, the Holy Spirit reminds us so clearly that God's word has to be taught in a manner that the entire audience can benefit from. It's so important that everybody sitting in the room gets to hear and understand and know how to apply God's word. You want to know what that means? That means that our church has to have a children's ministry. If not, do you know how I'm going to speak to the entire congregation? You guys are soaking down. This is what Joshua did. I can't teach children. I tried it a couple times. That's what I end up doing. They laugh at me and I walk away embarrassed. I have no idea how to teach children. All right. When I was serving in the Calvary Chapel School in Albuquerque, I was in charge of the elementary chapel services. And what I ended up doing was teaching the Bible with my voice and my guitar. And I would put together Bible studies that I could sing to the kids. And I wrote silly songs, and the kids learned the Bible through my silly songs. But once I decided I was just going to teach the elementary kids the way I taught the junior high and the high school kids, I want to tell you that was the worst morning of my life. It was just not my call. And this is really important. We have a children's ministry so that I can sit and teach you guys on the level that you can thrive at. I'll share a story. There's a movement in America. It's probably around the world. It's really gained a lot of speed in the last 20 years or so. It's called the Family Integrated Church Movement. And I won't speak negatively against it because I think a lot of good things come from it. But I had some people that were trying to get me to take Calvary Chapel of Greer in that direction a number of years ago. They kept telling me that having a children's ministry and a youth ministry was basically ungodly. It was unbiblical to separate children and youth from the rest of us. And they refused to put their kids in children's ministry. And one Wednesday night, as I'm teaching through, I believe it was the book of, we were in Leviticus, and just, we're all mature in here, no giggling, please. But the text talked about what a man was supposed to do if he had a nocturnal emission. And I've got this family with a bunch of tiny little kids right here, and I'm supposed to teach about these very mature, intimate things with like a 5-year-old and a 7-year-old and a 9-year-old looking up at me from the front row. And so I taught it as boldly and clearly without crossing any lines of vulgarity. And then at the end I said, and if any of you present don't know what these things are I talked about tonight, please ask your parents. But you know, I have to teach 1 Corinthians 7. It talks about the physical, intimate relationship between a husband and wife. I don't want to do that with 7-year-olds sitting in front of me. You want to know why? Because there's a portion of the book of Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, that tells us, do not arouse love before its time. I may be teaching adults things you guys need to hear, and little kids are going, whoa, can we listen to that tape again? No, they don't do tapes anymore. Can we get on the internet and watch that? It's so important. From the book of Nehemiah, Ezra's teaching, he said, please drop off your kids at the children's ministry if they're not old enough to understand what we're going to be talking about. And every once in a while, someone will get upset. They'll tell us how terribly unspiritual we are for asking people to put their children in the children's ministry. But I mean, how many of you, when we're in here and we're having a Bible study and we're just about to that Holy Spirit moment where someone's life is going to change, and then some little kid goes, "Mommy, I gotta go potty." And I'm up here going, "I knew that was going to happen. I've been praying all day. When we get to this point in the Bible study, like, God is going to shake the room." And so that's why we ask people, take your children to the children's ministry. You want to know why? Because you get an hour and a half break to worship God, hear His word, and know confidently that somebody is loving your kid and teaching them the word of God. It's so awesome. Verse 4, Ezra the scribe, he stood on a platform of wood which they had made for the purpose. And beside him at his right hand stood Mattathiah, Shema. Now I'm going to just skip all their names right here. Verse 5, Ezra opened the book on the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. What I want you to see here in this section that I just read is that, first of all, Ezra had a plan that was age-appropriate and orderly. And second, the word of God was held in the absolute highest honor. I want you to picture 50 to 60,000 people in this outdoor square packed together. They've built this platform for Ezra. He's up high, high enough that everybody can kind of see him. And as Ezra walks out, pretend this is a scroll. Ezra walks out, he sets the word of God down, he unrolls the scroll, and this holy hush goes out over 50 or 60,000 people. And notice that everybody stood up. They had such an honor and a reverence for the word of God that they stood. I found an interesting thing. This can't be proven biblically, but rabbinical tradition, the Jewish rabbis, rabbinical tradition says that since the time of Moses, the people of Israel would always stand at the opening and the reading of the word of God, whether it be in the temple or in a synagogue or in a home. If somebody brought out the word of God and opened it up, reverent Jews would stand in the presence of the word of God. And I got to thinking, and I'm going to offend somebody tonight. It's not my plan. I'm holding back, you know, a shaking voice and tears right now. But have we lost reverence for what we come here to do? I mean, if you go to some other church and it's just a dog and pony show, you know, whatever. But I want to tell you, we put such reverence on the teaching of the word of God here. And I wonder if we've just kind of lost reverence for the word of God in the way we conduct ourselves during our Bible studies and our services. You know, from up here, I see a lot more than what you guys see back there, okay? Ashley, you can see, what, three people between you and me? I see 100 or so, okay? And it's really interesting, but on any given church service, these are kind of the things that I've observed. And again, please don't be offended at me, but I know sometimes I see individual people who will leave the room multiple times to fill their coffee. I'm teaching the word. I'm up here teaching. I got like 25 hours of prayer and study and agonizing over the word. And you got to have a cup of coffee in the middle of it. Bring me one next time, okay? I think about people who have to make like 17 trips to the restroom during my Bible study. I'm beginning to wonder, they just don't like me. I see people whose phones light up sitting on the chair next to them, and they're kind of like, and we didn't see that. None of us. We didn't see it. Or how about, you guys remember a couple years ago in the old building, we had a lady and a man visiting. The lady in the front row, her phone rang. And it rang. And it rang. And it rang. She didn't even know it was hers. I compose myself. I get back to teaching. Just getting back in the groove. I'm sweating. I'm nervous. My voice is shaking. The phone rings a second time. She picks it up. She answers it and has a conversation in the front row at Calvary Chapel while I'm teaching on a Sunday morning. And I see like Tony and the other guys who were ushering at the time like standing looking at me like, should we shoot her? And I'm trying to take the edge off, but I mean, how often do people not even bring a Bible to church? And so they got nothing to look at. So it's just, you know, after a little while, I'm looking down and they're going, ooh, like that one. And I'm being a little bit funny trying to take the edge off, but the bottom, have we forgotten? Have we forgotten that this book is the only link between us and a holy, perfect God who gave his son for us? And we're so addicted to so many things, coffee and technology and everything, that we can't even sit through an hour Bible study without having to go do something else. And I just got to be honest with you. I've had to learn to click this little button on my phone and on my Mac computer when I'm working called Do Not Disturb, because I am so ADD that if something beeps, I'm just squirrel. And I've had to just every 45 minutes or hour during my study days, I'll take a break, I'll go to the restroom, I'll get a glass of water, I'll look, is there anything crucial? And then, you know, at the end of the day, I'll try to get back to emails or text messages and stuff. But listen, folks, the people in the city of Jerusalem, the word of God was opened, and this holy hush comes out, and they stood in reverence to the word of God. And then I want you to see what happened next. Ezra began the event with this time of worship, verse 6. It says that Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. And then all the people answered. And they said, amen, 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 while lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. God gave me some insight today, and it's like, this is how God trains pastors. God trains pastors as we're sitting in our study, reading and preparing Bible studies and praying. And it was just like, Ezra's so wise. He's a seasoned minister. He knows that people, when they arrive in Jerusalem to start the opening ceremony of the Feast of Trumpets, he knew that there were people who were going to show up extremely distracted. One guy and his family, they got a flat tire on the wagon on the way. They came in late and they're all flustered. They were probably barking at each other. You know how that happens? Fight on the way to church on Sunday morning or Wednesday night. Another family comes in, they're just agonizing over a wayward child. Another family comes in, they're agonizing over the fact that their finances are just, they don't know what they're going to do. Got another family that walks in and their marriage is falling apart. Another family that walks in and, you know, they got this problem and they got that problem. And Ezra's looking out and he's saying, we're about to have an amazing time with the Lord, and we need to bring some focus. And so Ezra starts, and notice he blessed the Lord. And this Hebrew word for blessed, if we were drawing a picture, if we were illustrating the Bible with pictures, what we would have is this man Ezra standing and then blessing the Lord verbally, falling to his knees with his hands up, and maybe just starting to sing a worship chorus that the people could follow. It's just Ezra's way of saying we're about to transition from the craziness of life into a time with the Lord, and we've got to have a time of transition and focus. And you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of our faithful, faithful worship teams here at Calvary that work so hard to transition us from the craziness of life and the stress over wayward children and finances and broken cars and all this stuff into the ability to receive the teaching of the Word of God by spending a half hour singing to Him. I'm so blessed by our worship teams and our various worship leaders. Ezra blessed the Lord and he sang praises to God. And I want you to notice something. And this is, again, I don't want to offend anybody, but this is just so powerful. I want you to notice what the people did. The people, notice, they answered, they spoke words, they lifted up their hands, they bowed their heads, but notice this, they worshiped the Lord. And the Hebrew word for worship is shakah, and it is so perfectly defined in the way that these people responded. And I want you to notice something, and please, please, please see this. Worshiping God in the city of Jerusalem was extremely expressive. One time we had this group come from, it was an African children's choir called Watoto. And I actually tried to get them here last year, and they're booked 2 years in advance. But we're on their schedule for like 2064 or something like that. We're actually trying to get them here. But it was interesting because there was one of their leaders had only been saved a couple of years. But he got saved in African churches, and as they came to America, he and I kind of, you know, just over the course of 2 days, really got to know each other. And he said, "Can I confide something in you?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "You white people are uptight in your worship." And I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He goes, "This is how American white people worship." He said, "You ought to see us in Africa, man. We're like jumping around and dancing and this and that and the other." Notice that their worship was expressive. This is a challenge. Why did we do two songs at the beginning of the service instead of four? Because we can have a time of three worship songs at the end of our Bible study tonight to just really try to express. Don't fake anything. I'm not trying to manufacture something here, but I want to show you what biblical worship looks like. The word shakah, first of all, it's expressive. Notice it was expressive with their voices and with their hearts. They responded to Ezra talking about how great God was by saying, "Amen, amen." It's like the worship team leading us in, "How great is our God?" And everybody is trying to sing louder, and the sound tech is trying to turn the system up. Eventually, we blow speakers and amps because the congregation is trying to sing louder than the worship team can come through the system. That's what we're looking at here. Ezra goes, "God is good," and the people are like, "Amen, amen." Notice they participated. And then notice they lifted up their hands. I wasn't always a Christian. And I know that when a policeman chases you and he catches you, he doesn't ever say, "Put your hands in your pockets." He says, "Doyle, what does a policeman say?" Doyle? Hands up. And what do you expect when the bad guy puts his hands up? What are they saying to you at that moment? "I surrender." I had to surrender a couple of times I've been forgiven. But I want you to notice they said amen. They participated by following the leaders, and then they surrendered to the Lord. There's nothing like entering into that moment of worship where the song is leading your heart to the throne of God, and all of a sudden you realize maybe it's the first time ever. I don't care what anybody around me thinks. I don't care what the person from work that I invited to church tonight thinks. I have got to say to God in this moment, "I surrender." And the hands go up. And then notice, the heart didn't go up with the hands. The pride didn't go up. They weren't going, "Man, I'm really hitting those harmony notes tonight. This is amazing." Look what happened to their heart. They bowed their heads and they worshiped face down. Kind of like this. Shakah literally means to turn towards or to bow to kiss, especially when it's translated into Greek. To turn towards in order to kiss. I wonder if that's how you worship God tonight. Surrendered. Humble. Bold. In agreement with what the worship leaders are bringing. And I just wrote this. This flowed out of me today. Oh, that the American church could learn to stop caring what people thought and start learning to worship God in an expressive manner. In an expressive manner. That we wouldn't fake it. I don't want, when the worship team comes back up, for us to all be like. I want us to express our hearts to the Lord. I want you to notice something else. The Bible teaching was both thorough and applicable. Here comes the teaching team, and this is so cool here. Verse 7, also Yeshua, Bani, this whole group of guys, I'm going to save time, and the Levites, they helped the people to understand the law. And the people stood in their place, so they read distinctly from the book in the law of God, and they gave the sense, and they helped them to understand the reading. They've had a time of worship. Their hearts are now prepared. Ezra comes up with this group of guys, one group on his right and another group on his left. Ezra opens the word, and what he did is he read distinctly from the book. He read the scripture. Okay, folks, this is the text we will cover tonight. And then, notice, after they read distinctly, they gave the sense, and then they helped the people to understand the reading. Look at the screen, Nehemiah 8:8 in the NIV. NIV is very understandable in Nehemiah 8:8. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Have you ever been in one of those Bible studies where the guy gets up and reads, but you just don't understand? You know, you're in some vague portion of Jeremiah, and he's up there reading, and you're just going, I don't understand the culture, I don't understand the context, I don't understand this, I surely don't know how to apply this, and I don't know God any better. But it didn't cost anything, so at least, you know, here we are. Ezra had a plan. He said, every time someone comes and sits under my teaching, I am going to exposit a text. First, I'm going to read it. Then I'm going to give them understanding. This is what the culture was like. This is what was going on in the world at that time. This is what the people were experiencing. Now they have a sense of it. And then he would give them understanding so that they could apply it to their lives. And if you noticed from a few verses back, they did this for over 6 hours in one sitting. I'm loving that. I'm really loving that. 6 hours, the people stood while Ezra sat, just so you know. And then when Ezra got tired, and it is, it's hard to teach. I was listening to a teaching by a friend of mine who pastors a very large Calvary Chapel down in Florida. And he was telling the congregation, he says, you know, I come into first service and I worship with you guys. And then I get up and I teach. He says, but I don't participate in the next three worship services. They have four Sunday morning services. This is Danny Hodges. And Danny said, it's not that I don't enjoy worshiping the Lord. It's just that after I've sung and preached, I can't sing and preach and sing and preach and sing and preach. And what you got here is you've got Ezra, who it's been 6 hours that he's teaching the word. He would get tired. And so these men on his right and on his left, they would take over. And they would teach and preach, and they would expound the scriptures and give the application. And then notice what would happen. The group of men out in the audience then took smaller groups and taught them the word also. Verse 7, these guys here and the Levites. Ezra would teach, but the people way back couldn't hear, so it would get relayed. It was kind of like how churches have small groups. You know, and so I'm teaching here on Sunday mornings, and then maybe small groups are meeting to get together and discuss the word. Now, this is what's cool, is that this thing we've been talking about this evening is the model that I've been following for my entire ministry. I've never been a topical Bible teacher. I tried it in the early days of my youth ministry, and I went to my pastor and I said, I'm having such a terrible time teaching. And he says, well, what are you doing? I said, I'm just trying to give him different topics, hot topics. In fact, I bought a book called Hot Topics for Youth. And he says, why don't you just take a book of the Bible? He says, what's your favorite book of the Bible? At the time, it was James. I said, oh, James. He says, how about you were just to teach the book of James to the youth? Me? He said, yeah, just study James and teach it half a chapter every week. And sure enough, started teaching expositorily, and that's what happened. Now, here at Calvary, occasionally, holidays and special events, I'll do a topical teaching. Once in a long while, mostly Christmas time, we'll do a topical series. But about 95% of the time here, we follow what we learn from Ezra. Just teach the word. Let people understand the word. Tell people how to apply the word. So we're on to our second to last section. The next essential element of a true revival is found in verse 9. And this is that the word of God produces conviction, repentance, and restoration. This is really powerful here. Nehemiah, who was the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept, and then they heard the words of the law. I asked you to mark 2 Timothy chapter 3. Please turn there very quickly. You got a group of people. They're hearing the word taught. Some of them haven't heard the word of God in a long time. Some who came with Nehemiah have probably never really heard the word of God taught. It probably wasn't a big emphasis in Babylon to teach the word, and now they're back in the holy city, and Ezra is just laying down the word of God. Other leaders are explaining it, and these people are just being confronted because the word is like a mirror, and they start seeing in their own lives a lot of the thou shall nots. And then in their own lives, they're not seeing the thou shalls. They're realizing we're really falling short. We're so far from God. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 shed some light. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. We know that that literally means all scripture is God-breathed. And it is profitable. And I want to stop there for a minute. Anybody in the room ever struggle with your morning quiet time? I struggle. I mean, sometimes I have these fantastic seasons, but I'm like you. I struggle sometimes. I wake up and I'm tired and, you know, my brain doesn't work. I have some coffee and I start reading and, you know, I read through the Bible regularly and I get to Leviticus, you know, and I'm like, Leviticus again? We were just here 6 months ago, you know, and it's like, you know, but I've learned to love Leviticus because it's profitable. No matter what I read in the morning, I am going to profit from God's word. No matter what you read, no matter how hard or dry that season is, you are profiting from the investment you're making in God's word. Notice how it profits us. First of all, for doctrine, it gives us right understanding of God and right understanding of spiritual things. We just spent 2 weeks in 2 Peter on Sunday mornings talking about false teachers and false doctrines. How do we know what's right? The word of God tells us. And then it's profitable for reproof. This means to reveal where your current beliefs or your current practices are wrong. And then for correction, to show you how to make these wrong things right again. The word of God is profitable for instruction in righteousness. This is how to have a right relationship with God, a right relationship with other human beings. And then verse 17, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work, that we may go on to maturity and have the kind of ministry that causes the kingdom of God to move forward the way it's supposed to. This all comes from the teaching of the word of God. But I want you to notice back here in verse 16 that reproof and correction and instruction in righteousness were a big part, is a big part of what the word of God brings into our lives. And these believers, as you're turning back to Nehemiah chapter 8, these people, they're hearing the word of God read, they're hearing the word of God explained, they're told how to apply it to their life, and they begin to weep because they're falling under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And they're beginning to realize we do more wrong than we do right. And they're just going, do you ever feel like that? I go through seasons like that. Every time I open the word, I just feel like God's saying, help, you know, help, Lord. What happened is that these people wept. It's good to weep over our sin. It is good when the word of God shows us that we are in a bad place and it leads us to weep in the presence of the Lord. God, I hate my sin. I hate it so much, and it just seems to constantly creep back into my life, and it's good. But I think what Ezra and Nehemiah and the Levites were finding is that there was a group of people who were weeping over their sin, and then the leaders would come and say, but God wants to forgive you. Well, what do I need to do? Confess it as sin, repent, and be restored. Amen, hallelujah, I'm healed of my sin. You know, and a charismatic movement started moving through the city of Jerusalem, except that there was this group that could not be consoled. Oh, we're just the worst of sinners. I'm no good for nothing. I should go jump off into the valley and kill myself, you know. You ever deal with Christians like that? No matter how much you try to instruct them and console them, all they can do is see how bad they are. Listen to 1 John 1:9. Look up at the screen. We're told that if we confess our sin, God is faithful. He is just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This principle existed in the Old Testament. And these leaders would have been saying to the people, well, listen, God loves you. That's why he's revealed your sin to you. God wants to forgive you. That's why you need to confess it and repent. God wants to restore you. Would you pray with me now? And the people are like, no, I'm just not worth it. I don't see how God could ever love me. Quote from one of my favorite Bible commentators up on the screen. Our knowledge of sin should never be bigger than our knowledge of Jesus as our Savior. We may commit great sin, but he is a greater Savior. Amen. Let's say amen, amen to that one.
Amen.
These people were just inconsolable, so Nehemiah, Ezra, and the Levites had to get into some additional teaching. Look at verse 10. Then he said to them, go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, send portions for those for whom nothing is prepared, for this day is holy to our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Do you realize what they're saying to them? They're saying, this is a festival. You're supposed to be here to celebrate the forgiveness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord, and you guys are being a real bummer for the rest of everybody's who's here. Here, how about let's get back to some biblical thinking. Did you sin? Yes. Have you confessed it? Yes. Are you sorry for it? Yes. Are you going to turn your back on it? Yes. Then according to Scripture, God has forgiven you. Let's rejoice. And so he says to them, would you please go do this? Go your way. In other words, stop weeping here. Get out there. Tell somebody. He says, eat the fat. You know, during these festivals, they sacrificed animals and they ate like crazy. Go get some food. Go get something good to drink. I think this is probably some really good coffee that they had there. It says drink the sweet, probably like a flat white or something like that. Send portions to those for whom nothing is prepared. You know, those people who were too spiritual to come to Jerusalem to worship with the rest of us? Take them something too. Go bless them. And then verse 11. Oh, no. Look at this last part. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And they're basically saying sin makes you weak. It has made you weak for a long season. But please remember that when you repent and God's joy comes into your heart, he restores your strength. Verse 11. So the Levites quieted all the people, saying, be still, for the day is holy. Do not be grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and drink, to send portions and rejoice greatly, because they understood the words that were declared to them. Ezra taught, the word was explained, the people understood, and the people applied God's word to their life. And it's really, really exciting to see that. And there's one more element to a true revival. We'll look at it, and then we're going to spend a few minutes worshiping. Whenever there's a true revival, you will always have, during that revival, a radical return to biblical living. A radical return to biblical living. Verses 13 through 18. Now on the second day, so all of that happened on the first day of the feast. On the second day, the heads of the fathers' houses of all the people with the priests and Levites were gathered to Ezra the scribe in order to understand the words of the law. Let me explain what that means. The leaders of the family tribes and clans, they were the leaders of the community. They were the judges, and they were the ones who were supposed to give direction to the entire community. And it appears that they request a private audience with Pastor Ezra for one specific reason. Look here, they wanted to understand the words of the law. They kind of come before him and they say, listen, we realize we have a very important role among God's people, but we also realize that we are not leading our families, our ministries, or these roles that God has given us in a biblical manner, because we don't know the Word of God. So we want you to teach us so that we can effectively lead the people. And you know, I don't want to go too far off on this one, but we're living in a day and age where even seminaries don't teach the Word of God to people. There's more psychology classes than there are Bible classes. There's more classes on how to go out and read the demographics of a neighborhood before planting a church, so you'll know how to reach that community. And the one thing that I think is so important, more important than anything, if a man's going to go out and call himself a pastor and a shepherd of the flock, he's got to be a man of the word. That's what we saw about Ezra. It's so important. So Ezra looks at these guys and he says, I tell you what, I'll teach you how to be a good leader. Look at verse 14. They found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths during the feast of the seventh month, that they should announce and proclaim in all their cities and in Jerusalem, saying, go out to the mountain and bring olive branches, branches of oil trees, myrtle branches, palm branches, and branches of leafy trees to make booths, as it is written. And what Ezra does, and this is a cool biblical principle, he found something that immediately applied to these guys. In other words, it was the time of the Feast of Tabernacles. And so he says, I'm going to teach you how to be a good leader. Let's look at what's right in front of us right now. It's Feast of Tabernacles. And if you were to turn to Leviticus 23, 37 through 43, you would find that this is how God instructs you to instruct the people to build booths so that they can fulfill this requirement of Scripture. And this is something that I'll just say to you, and then we'll begin to draw this to a close. If you're hungry for God's word and you're ready to make radical changes in your life, find one thing that you're dealing with right now that you know is unbiblical in your life. Search the scriptures until you find what God's word says about it and begin being obedient to that one thing, and it'll turn into a snowball effect where that one area of growth will cause other areas of your life to grow. And in a period of like 6 months, if you're doing this, you will be so radically transformed you won't even recognize yourself. And then verse 16, the people went out. This is so cool. And they brought them. In other words, all these branches and stuff, they went to the mountains and they got them and they made booths. Each one on the roof of his house and in the courtyards, the courts of the house of God, and in the open square of the water gate and the open square of the gate of Ephraim. So the whole assembly of those who had returned from the captivity made booths and they sat under the booths. And what we see right here is that there was this radical return to biblical living. And you may say, this is not that big of a deal. I thought this was going to say that, you know, there were crack addicts and, you know, drug dealers and this and that, and they were all repenting. No, this is really important. Let me show you why. For since the days of Joshua, this is over 1,000 years before, for since the days of Joshua, the son of Nun, until that day, the children of Israel had not done so. And there was very great gladness. There was something that these people were supposed to be doing regularly for over 1,000 years that they hadn't been doing, that God had instructed them to do. And now, in just a 2-day period, this revival breaks out. The word of God goes forth. The people have radical return to biblical living. And also day by day, from the first day until the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God, and they kept the feast 7 days. And on the 8th day, there was a sacred assembly according to the prescribed manner. It just kept teaching the word and kept living the word. And so what I did is I put together 5 things that I think we should take away. And the reason is because I followed the pattern that I've always followed when I teach the word. And it comes from Ezra 8:8. Did I read the word to you? We started by reading the first 12 verses, right? Did I then give you the meaning so that you'd understand the chapter? And do you understand the chapter? Good. Now is the time that we take a few minutes to give some personal applications. We made some along the way, but here are just some generalities. 5 things to help each of us immediately revive our walk with God, and I'll put them up on the screen. This is a time you can use your camera in church. I do this at men's Bible study. When Pastor Mark puts things up on the screen, I can't write it all down. I just go with my phone. So if you want to do that now, I won't condemn you. Number one. Be willing to forsake what's good for what's best. Be willing to forsake what's good for what's best. There's a lot of good things that we're called to do in life, but there are things that are better. You know, sometimes you've got to make that decision. You know, am I going to go to the Seder, or are we going to go to the football game that's going on? That's between you and the Lord, but I think the Seder is going to produce more fruit in your life. That kind of stuff, okay? Second thing. Ask God to give you an unquenchable hunger and thirst for His word. They came to Ezra and they said, get your Bible out, man, and teach us. The third thing, make the word of God and worship the focus of your gathering with the saints. When you get together with people, focus on the word of God and worshiping Jesus. Number four, trust God's word to produce conviction, confession, repentance, restoration, and celebration of your freedom from sin. Sometimes in my quiet time, God will nail me with something. And I hit this place where I'm like, oh, I'm feeling so convicted. And then I confess, and then I repent. And I experience, like in just a few moments, this restoration and this joy because God says to me, it's done, right? Yeah, you walked into your quiet time with this sin in your life, and we've talked about that. You're done, right? Yes, sir. And I'm joyful about it. And then the last one, commit yourself to radically return to biblical living. As you read the word, make a decision. That's God's word, and that is what I am going to do. If you do these five things, I think you'll experience a personal revival. Amen? Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for your word. Thank you so much, Lord, that we can sit here and we can study it and we can learn. We can confront ourselves. We can make ourselves extremely uncomfortable and then turn around and experience the wonderful comfort of the Holy Spirit as you minister to us. So, Father, we just pray as we spend a few minutes worshiping you, draw us into your presence. Remind us tonight, Lord, of the way the people of Israel worshiped you, Lord, with complete abandon, with surrender, with agreement with what was being said, with humility, hands held high, but eyes focused low because, Lord, we're humble in your presence. Pray tonight, Lord, that as we look at these things and we learn that we would experience a personal revival and that we would just draw close to you. In Jesus' name, amen.